I request the High Trust of Pant and IRSHonorable to briefly introduce Sri Prithvik Pandey
is an IAS officer as well, coming from the 1998 batch. He finished his graduation in the year 1996 from IIT Kanpur from the Electronical Engineering batch. He is the Chief Commissioner of Commercial Taxes from 2014, presently working in Karnataka. He has also held several positions and has contributed in the areas of State Budget and Director Budget. He is basically from Lucknow and presently he is holding the right position in Karnataka, which is spearheading the Commercial Taxes Department at the time when we are all implementing the GST. With this brief introduction, I welcome sir once again. Over to you, sir.
Chairman of Bangalore Chan. Mr. Devraj and my team colleagues from the accounting profession. It is indeed my privilege here to come and address, give a keynote address in this one-day seminar that we are having on GST. It is very essential that we have such, you know, kind of knowledge dissemination amongst ourselves, because, you know, none of us really, it would be very unfair to say that, you know, somebody, XYZ person knows more than some ABC person, because we are all kind of finding our way through this very complicated maze of how GST should be implemented in our country, given the circumstances that we are having today. I mean, you know, many people say that it should be like a one monolithic GST that we should have in our country. That would be a very ideal situation, one GST, one rate for all commodities, completely no negative list, no exemption, no partial exemption, no partial rebating, nothing. You know, it should be like one GST structure that we should have. But we all know that we live in a practical world, and India being a very complicated country, it is not very possible to have a structure like that. And the kind of GST that has been envisaged, now you must have most of the business processes are there. This is the first time that Government of India has made public. A lot of this groundwork was happening in past 1.5-2 years. But what was coming to public domain was mostly through informal channels and, you know, through very selective things were coming out. And so first time they have put it in public domain, these four business processes, which is most critical. You know, they are very critical for general business at large, the traders, the service providers, the accounting fraternity, the software developers. No? These business processes are very critical. They are front end business processes. That is how they were defined, and that is how they were viewed upon, and they were identified to be worked upon through a cooperative process between center and states. So the way GST has been envisaged, you must have seen by now. The first discussion draft, which had come quite some time back, didn't give quite amount of, you know, design details of GST. But if you see now that the design details are out, although it is like a dual GST, as sir just pointed out, that it is the same transaction which should be taxed by both central and state governments. But you know, it is like one GST only. It is only that at the back end, it is kind of being split. So the effort has been made, although legally speaking, there will be two taxes, and they will be legislated through different, levied through different laws, and the laws will be different. At any given point of time, there will be two laws which will be governing the same tax on the same transaction. But the way it is being designed is that there will be complete coherence between the two taxes, and this is very evident from the business process documents that you would have seen, that there will be one registration form. We haven't seen such a situation till now, that there will be one return form which will be submitted and will be used by two tax jurisdictions. And we have not come across that situation when we were having these deliberations. I mean, of course, the tax, you know, the tax administration from when the discussion started, there was certain key understanding, but, you know, some bottom lines which were there, which we all understood when we sat on the drawing board, saying that, you know, we can't have a split, we can't have a situation where the dealer applies or the taxpayer applies both to the central as well as the state government. It is not possible. We can't have such a system. It will be very retrograde, especially given the IT readiness or the IT know-how which is available today in the country or in the world. It would be very unfair to say that we will have two forms which will be submitted separately to central and state governments, and they will be handled separately. So a lot of thought has gone into, and a lot of understanding has been there on these core principles while designing these business processes, and to make it look as if it is, although it is, legally speaking, very technically speaking, they are two different taxes, all, completely independent of each other. But by imposing these kind of restrictions upon us, it has been made in such a way that it is part of two parts of the same monolithic GST. So it is as if it is one GST. The buyer, when he goes, he pays one GST to the supplier. And the supplier then pays as if it is one GST to the government. I mean, if you see the payment process, the way it is one challan. So he pays if it is an electronic transaction, he does one electronic transaction, and the taxes get split depending on the challan that he has filled or the return that he has filed automatically in the back end. So that is what has gone, the thought process, the basic bottom line, the starting point of all the business process has been this, that it should be like two parts of the same unified GST. Even now when the law is being discussed, the way it is being discussed is that the central GST law and the state GST law should be a mirror image of each other. So wherever it says central government, it should say the state GST law should say state government. Wherever it says central commissioner, there it should be state commissioner. There it says joint commissioner, here it should be joint commissioner. So the way it is being designed is that, at least to begin with, we don't know how it will evolve in years to come, 10 years down the line, 5 years down the line, we don't know exactly. But to begin with, our endeavor is that the state and the central GST law should be complete mirror image of each other. So the whole design philosophy is like this. It is very essential for why I'm discussing upon this point is because for us, for tax administrators, you are the field functionaries who will disseminate this information. Many people say that there are three taxes actually. There is central GST, there is state GST, and there is IGST. As if CST was a different tax. It was not part of VAT. But the IGST, which is designed today, it is not as if it is a different tax. IGST is the core of the entire GST structure. When GST was designed, one of the primary driving concern was that the design should be such that it integrates India as one common market. And IGST delivers that promise. So, IGST, in fact, the first report which was the first design which was decided was the IGST model, and after that these business processes have been designed. So IGST is at the core of the GST structure that has been envisaged. IGST is basically a mechanism. It is a mechanism for credit flow between CGST in one state and CGST in another state, SGST in one state and SGST in another state. So, today CST puts a kind of a bar saying that it has a cascading effect. Second, it has some kind of, a restricting effect on how trade will take place. So today, if India had to be woven into one big market, as if, it was one tax being paid and credit was flowing freely between one sale in one state to another sale in one state, or service provided in one state, service consumed in another state. Now, there were two, three models that were considered And the IGST model, which is now has been adopted, is a lot of, you know, thought process has gone into it, and the way it has been designed is that it should reduce credit getting stuck at any given point of time. So this is, in our view, this was one optimal model which minimizes credit getting stuck, and therefore refunds, situation of refunds getting arisen. Today, interstate trade has this problem of VAT refunds being taken in one state and VAT being paid then in another state. So IGST model basically, you know, kind of obviates that requirement. It removes that requirement that you, any interstate trade will require any refund. So what IGST says is that if you are doing any interstate trade, you don't pay CGST and SGST. You instead pay IGST. So this kind of, you know, and once you have paid IGST, IGST is kind of a pan, that is the only pan India tax that is being envisaged in the GST structure. The other two taxes are kind of a very state specific tax. Although CGST is a central levy, but it is localized. It is within a particular state. SGST is anywhere state levy. So IGST is the only tax which will have a pan India kind of a presence. So IGST paid in one state will be recognized in the other state. That is how it has been envisaged. So that is the difference between SGST, CGST and IGST. So IGST is invariably a combination of SGST and CGST, but that CGST and SGST which will be recognized, which will be paid in one state but will be recognized in the other state. So you know, this kind of confusion, again, why I am stressing on this point is because, again, you are the people who, it's very easy for you to understand these principles because you are technically competent, and it is very easy for you to then further disseminate this information because you have a large audience base. So, and when I say that, you know, I don't, you know, when I say that it's pretty simple, then people may not accept it, you know, because your clients may not accept when I say, but when you say the same thing, they will accept it more liberally and more, they'll more accepting to that particular logic than so IGST, if you see the way it has been woven, is that, and that is why, you know, when CGST credit, when SGST credit is taken to pay IGST, or when IGST credit is taken to pay CGST or SGST, there will be a lot of fund transfer between central and states happening at the back end, which is nothing to do with the taxpayer. It is, so suppose I have made an interstate purchase and I have paid IGST to my seller, and then now I have only local sales to make. So I am basically an importer in the state. I import goods from other state. I buy from Tamil Nadu and sell in Karnataka. Then I will be paying IGST to my seller, and I will be locally collecting only SGST. So therefore, my liability is only SGST, but my credit is IGST. So the law allows, the business process allows setting off IGST credit against SGST. And when it happens, IGST is a central levy. It will be collected by the central government, but it is a temporary levy. You know, ideally speaking, at a given point of time, the total IGST which has been collected should be zero, because whatever IGST has been collected should have been set off against. In a practical sense, it will not be, because certain IGST will not be taken set off, because there will be B2C kind of transactions, there will be certain transactions in which credit could not flow, where credit was inadmissible kind of a thing. So, but if I have such situation where I have SGST liability and I have IGST credit, the structure allows me to take that credit and pay only the remaining SGST which I have to pay, and taking credit of IGST paid. Now therefore, if you would appreciate that, to that extent, that state gets less revenue because, you know, set off has been taken. The credit which has been taken, the actual money is in the hand of central government. So at the back end, the central government has to pay that much money to the state government. And the reverse will also happen. Suppose I am a local buyer and I only sell interstate. So when I locally source my products, I basically pay SGST to my sellers. And when I sell interstate, I collect IGST from my buyers, and I pay this IGST to the central government. When I pay IGST, I only have credit of SGST available for me. I don't have IGST credit. But that structure allows me to take that credit. And in such cases, central government has taken a hit. It has collected less IGST because the person has taken an SGST credit and the money lies in the hands of the state government now. So the state government has to pay that amount to the central government to that extent. And you would see that when IGST, once he pays IGST, that goes to the central government. It is a B2B transaction, then that person will in turn pay SGST, and then you know, so there will be, suppose in a very complex or in a real time or real life situation, a dealer in Karnataka buys locally, sells to Tamil Nadu, the Tamil Nadu dealer is now an interstate buyer and sells locally. So there will be money Karnataka will be paying to the central government and central government will be paying to Tamil Nadu government. So the basic structure of IGST is such that it is a mechanism to make GST a destination-based tax. That's it. Otherwise, IGST is a washout. So, and what it does in practice is that it basically obviates the need for any kind of refunds. Now, there are no refunds in this whole structure. Everybody pays tax and gets the credit of whatever he has paid. And then, you know, fund transfer takes place between the central and state government. So, what has been done is that instead of doing fund transfer between the dealer taking refund in Karnataka and then the next dealer paying the entire tax in Tamil Nadu, it has been made in such a fashion that central government acts like an exchange of money between states, and so the burden of fund transfer has been removed from the taxpayer and has been taken towards government. It is today, in today's world, it is possible because the IT infrastructure that we have today allows us to have such a complex systems without with very little scope of errors and all. So the whole structure, if you see, has been designed in such a way to kind of, given our federal structure that we have and the kind of needs, the federal fiscal relationship that we have in our country, without disturbing that kind of federal fiscal structure, how a unified GST kind of a structure is unified, although the implementation may be, you know, slightly dual in nature, but it is, that is how the whole business process has been. So all the business processes are there in your hands now. We really look forward to the feedback because your feedback will be fairly dispassionate, it will be slightly less emotional, it will be more technical, will be more it will polish the when these business processes, you would also appreciate when we sit and make the business processes, we only have the tax administration's viewpoint. I mean, we have the taxpayer's viewpoint is fairly filtered. I mean, we get tinted by our tax administration glass. So whenever we will make these business processes, we will try to make it more and more foolproof, evasion proof, misuse proof kind of a thing. And then, you know, maybe the dealer friendliness also is one of the concerns, but it gets tinted to a large extent. Really, it becomes tinted. It is not that it is intentional, but sometimes it will always get tinted because tax collection is our primary concern. So, but you have this, you know, a very unique position where you are slightly dispassionate also because you are not direct taxpayers in that sense, but you have very close linkage with the taxpayers. You know their boundaries, limits, their restrictions, how much IT awareness, how much, what are their capabilities and all. So we really look forward to the body to give us very positive feedback, which will polish the business processes. No business process can be perfect. It will get perfect over the period of years when we launch. On the day GST will be launched, there is no doubt that there will be a lot of confusion, a lot of chaos. We will also not be knowing a lot of situations. Even you will not be able to envisage all the situations that can arise once it gets implemented. But as much as we can, you know, think through it, we can be forward-looking, it would be very convenient for us. So I would really urge you to go through the business process in great detail. Ask as many questions as possible. Not because we can always give an answer. There are many questions which we cannot answer, maybe. But by knowing those questions, we would know what kind of answers need to be found. And your suggestions, because they will really polish the business processes before it is implemented. Lot of questions and answers will also clear a lot of doubts between us. It will be some things which I may think is obvious that it has communicated, which may, the report may not have communicated. Question and answers, a dialogue basically clears those communication gaps also. So I would really urge upon you, and I would like to thank you all for giving me this opportunity to speak here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for sharing the more informative words it is.